Good morning and welcome to Summit Community Church. We're glad that you could join us online on YouTube. We are looking forward to a great morning of worship this morning. The congregation is here and ready to sing. Let's stand and sing together. All hail the power of Jesus' name. Today we're going to be talking about clearing our vision so that we can see what we have not been able to see. I don't know if you realize this, but you can see the Lord. The Lord says, if you seek me, you will find me when you search for me with all your heart. He is ready to be found and he wants to be found. So why can't we see him? Why can't we sense his presence? We're going to discuss that today.
Thank you. days of Elijah, declaring the word of the Lord. These are the days of your servant Moses, whose righteousness be restored. And though these are days of the trials, days of Ezekiel, the dry bones becoming as flesh. These are the days of your servant David, rebuilding a temple of praise. And these are the days of the harvest, of fields are as wine in the
Father, these are some interesting days. Many of us feel like the world seems to be coming to an end. Some people want that to happen sooner rather than later. It's all in your timing, Lord. We don't know what happens when, but we know this, that you are in control and that you've called us to live in a way that we can see you. You've given us the ability to see. You've given us the eyes, but Lord, we do not see so often. We do not sense your presence. Even when you were standing next to us, Lord, we cannot sense that you are with us. And we ask, where are you, Lord? I pray that you would open our eyes that we may see today. I pray that you may open the ears that we have that we may hear the truth. Then you would open our voice, our mouths, that we may speak the truth. Father, help us to get in a position to hear. That we need to be prepared for what you want to say to us, so that then we can help to build your kingdom. You've called us to work. Let us get busy, Lord. There's plenty to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Be seated. Well, we are, as you can tell, we are in making progress. We're in the second week of our project out front. And when you got here this morning, it was a little harder to get in. Dan Hayward called last night, said, can I come to church yet? I said, Dan, I'm sorry. I said, it's not going to be a, but I said, I guarantee you can come next week. I will fix it somehow that he can get in the church next week. He's aching to come. So he says, well, tell everybody I miss him. And Dee Dee said the same thing. I talked to her this morning and she said, tell everybody how much we miss them and we'll be back. We just got to get our strength back. So anyway, we are looking forward to the return of several folks dealing with COVID. COVID is still happening. It's not nearly the crisis it was, but my daughter has her best friend is right now dealing with COVID, and her whole family went through it recently. We are now all vaccinated in the process. I get my last shot this week, and Katie gets hers next week, or in a couple of weeks. Amy gets hers. Yeah, Katie's been vaccinated since like 2 years ago. But then we're all going to be vaccinated, and I told Jeannie, I said, baby, go get in the truck. We're going down to see my sister as soon as we can. We're going to go get in the truck, and we're going to go down and see my sister down in Texas as soon as we can. I've been feeling just really sad that I haven't been able to be with her for the last year and a half. I went down twice, was unable to see her, but except through a window. And that just wasn't good enough. So we're going to go down and be able to be with her and to be in the same room and hold and touch and hug and all that good stuff since we're vaccinated. And it's in Texas, and there anything goes now in Texas. So kind of the opposite of Oregon. So be praying for those that still have COVID. But anyway, we are excited about what's happening out front of the church. We've got the footers poured for the new ramp and entrance to our front. And we're going to need to get some doors ordered and get those purchased so that we can use our new front entrance. We'll be able to use the man door until we get the two bigger doors delivered. But we're making progress. We're spending a lot of money, a lot of the money that you've been faithful to give over the years. It's an expensive process. Right now is the hardest time. It's the most challenging environment to ever build in history because stuff is so expensive. I have been dealing all week with just trying to save a few dollars a sheet on oriented strand board. We need 50 sheets of it. Last year I got it for $7 a sheet, and right now it's $80. Have you ever seen anything go up over 1,100% in 6 months? That's what we're facing. So maybe we want to delay this till next year. I don't know. But, no, we're working on it. I thought I had a solution, but then found out that wouldn't pass inspection because it wasn't rated for outdoor use. You can get finished 3/4-inch maple plywood for cheaper than you can get oriented strand board right now. Can you believe that?
No.
But they wouldn't let me use maple out there. They said, it's not outdoor rated. I said, I don't care, it's prettier. Well, anyway, so we're gonna work on that this week. We're trying to get the cost down, but you're gonna begin to see things next week begin to take shape. Everything has been ordered. Trevor's doing a great job. He's been an excellent job keeping in contact with me. That's our contractor. And one of the guy that's doing his concrete work is a very strong believer. And we've had some good talks, so it's been good getting to know them. Yeah. So we're excited about what's going on outside, and hopefully within a month it will be complete. Not totally complete, but mostly complete, meaning the contractor's part will be done, then it's up to us to put the roof on. I'll get it shielded in and watertight so it won't leak, but it'll take me a little bit longer to get the roof on because I'm behind it, my other work. So we'll get that done. And so things are progressing. So keep praying. Thank you for your faithful giving and being here today. We have two Bible studies this week, Wednesday at 1:00 right here at the church.
When we can get in.
You couldn't get in?
They were pouring footings on Wednesday, so we came in and said, well, there's no place to park and you can't get in anymore.
Well, you can always enter in this door.
I did.
Oh, okay. Yeah. This door is usually out of the field of construction. So if you come for Bible study, park back here under the basketball goal and come in this corner door. Surely we'll get that one open for you. But try to avoid that while they're working.
It's a step.
There is a step, but I can put another, I can put a better one over there. I'll do that today.
Yeah.
I'll get it fixed.
Yeah.
I put one up for Barb. I just didn't get it up before church for the rest of you. And in 2 weeks, next week is Memorial Day, but in 2 weeks, Kathy has been working on a report for you, a financial report. She wants to give you an update for the financial situation and where our spending is and how much money we're spending, and it's quite a bit. But it's good. It's a good investment. We have the money, and we're going to use it, and we're going to get this building in good shape. We're going to be good stewards of this facility. And I'm excited about getting that work completed. I talked with Bill Schertzinger this week a couple times, and he's excited to see the finished product as well. So we are going to have a meeting in 2 weeks after church. So the week after Memorial Day, feel free to join us. We are going to have a brief financial update meeting after church that Kathy will be sharing with us where we're at. And we might also talk about that. I want to put on the agenda to talk about adding the Wi-Fi system here, because we've had more and more groups request to come that I can't accommodate because we don't have Wi-Fi. So I'd like to get that going soon. But that will be a process. It'll be 50, 60 bucks a month, I think, to have Wi-Fi here. Maybe more? Okay. But I think it's something that we're kind of going to need to join the rest of the world in the 21st century here pretty quick.
It's hard.
It is hard. It's hard, especially if you're from Lake County, I tell you what. Did you see the Oregon Experience on Lake County this week?
No.
It was excellent.
That would be on TV, right?
Yeah. Yeah, talked about Rube.
Rube Long.
Rube Long, yeah. Talked about his book and everything. Yeah, I thought of you the whole time. So we are glad that everybody's back here today. Let's talk about the folks on our prayer list. We've had some updates this week. First, we want to continue to pray for Raphael. He was released from prison. He is out. I spoke with him Friday briefly. He was working at the time and said, well, let me call you back tomorrow. But he hasn't called back yet. We'll probably talk today. So I'm excited to talk to him. Frank has talked to him after he got released. But we've been praying for Raphael for years to continue the journey he began with the Lord while he was in prison. So now that his feet are on the ground, we're really going to need to be praying for him. It's going to be a hard adjustment for him to come out of prison after 15 years. Most of his adult life has been spent in prison. So, but he has a new heart, and he is hoping that God will lead him to a better place this time, and we are praying for that. It's going to be hard work on his part as well. As we've learned, God doesn't do it all. We've got to also do our part. It's a collaboration between us and the Lord. But Frank would like the chance to help his grandson as well, so we're hoping that he'll move up here. So Raphael, if you get to see this, we've been praying for you, and we're looking forward to meeting you. And we also want to be praying for Lenora Sparks. That's Barb's sister, cousin, who was injured tragically in a bad accident a week and a half ago, and she lost her leg in the accident, but she is recovering. We want to continue to pray for her in her recovery and adjusting to this new life. She did lose her leg below the knee, which is good because she'll have much better use of it mobility-wise, and she's in her 70s. Or how old is
mid-70s.
She? Mid-70s, yeah.
She was just transferred to a rehab center.
She is, okay. Well, let's be praying for her. And I got a pretty rough update yesterday of my friend Joyce. Joyce has not been doing well in her recovery. I've been texting her and calling her, and she hasn't been answering. And now I know a little bit more why. She's really been struggling since she had her hip replacement surgery. I spoke to her afterwards, and she was up walking around, and it sounded like she was going to make a strong comeback. But she has hit some roadblocks. She's had complications. Her wound has been very slow to heal and got infected. And she has been transferred down to a place in Texas, so near her son and daughter-in-law, and they're selling her home in Oklahoma, which means she probably won't be able to live alone again, which is a sad day for her. She loved her home, and she was hoping that she could stay there, but evidently that's not going to happen. So when we go down there, we might try to go down and see her again. I just love this lady with all my heart. She is just the most amazing person, and it just breaks my heart. But I know that she's ready whenever the Lord wants her. And it's just one of those things that you've got to accept. Dee Dee is doing better. Dee Dee is regaining strength slowly. I talked to her briefly, and she is at home and on antibiotics. That has helped to overcome all the symptoms from COVID. Now she's just feeling very weak and tired. So she just needs prayers for her energy level to come back, that she can regain her strength enough to go out and start working her muscles back into shape, because she's been so lethargic, she hasn't been able to walk much. So be praying for Dee Dee. She's had a long road, but she's still got a good attitude. She always says almost every conversation, oh, I've got it so much better than everybody else. So be praying for Dee Dee. Dee Dee, we love you, we miss you, and Joanne and Terry too. We look forward to seeing you soon. Also continue to pray for Tracy and her treatment. She's been on medication now for a couple of weeks, and we were praying for her to keep going strong. After the medication started, she hasn't felt any strong side effects. That's a wonderful blessing. She has, indefinite treatment, really. Could be on that medication for years, but they're treating it with that rather than chemo and radiation. So we also want to pray for Marlis. She's still recovering from her second back surgery. The pain is much better, and she is recovering, but I'm going to try to get by and see them this week. Jody is Dan and Sandy's daughter. She has back and heart problems. Continue to pray for her. Talked to Dan last night. He was in good spirits. He was a little disappointed he couldn't come today, but I told him next week, we'll get you in here. So I don't know how I'm going to do it, but we'll do it. I'll figure something out. Also, be praying for Gloria and Jim Kraft. Jim is still receiving chemo. Rachel and Stephen Amai, as they are looking for God's direction in their life in Uganda. And for those fighting cancer, Michelle Smith, Francis Mulliner, Lulu Kelly, Jim Kraft, Marlene and Terry Rennie, Beth Barnes, and David Winters. And Lulu Kelly, of course, is on hospice care. We want to be remembering her and her family. Are there any other prayer requests that you bring this morning? Yes, LB.
I was going to give you a report on David Winters.
Yes.
He's doing a lot better. Okay. Prayer has done something for him. And friendship has done more something for him, too, evidently. I think God sent me at the right time.
Amen.
through my wife, she kind of prodded me to go see him. But he's doing really amazingly different.
And he had
sarcoma.
Sarcoma, yeah.
And he can now work. He's been working 8-10 hour days where he could barely work 2 or 3. So it's just amazing. And then I have another friend that used to drive bus. Jonathan Van Bleed is his name. And he is not, actually, he's been fighting COVID. I should have called you about 3 weeks ago. He's been in the hospital. He went downhill. He was here in the St. Charles Hospital, and they looked around. They thought they were going to have to send him as far as Salt Lake City to get better treatment. But he is up in Washington somewhere. I can't remember exactly where. Heavily sedated with the tracheotomy and everything, but he's getting a lot better. I just was looking at the report. I look on Facebook and get reports from him, and he is looking up. You know, nobody can really personally visit him except his wife. I guess they just let her in, but they've been Zooming with him, and he is doing better. He recognizes voices now. And
did you say he's at St. Charles?
No, he's up in Washington somewhere.
Okay. But he's in the hospital.
But he is in the hospital. They took him up there because they had some kind of ECMO, I don't know what that is, special
ECMO.
Treatment.
ECMO.
ECMO, yeah.
Yeah.
Up there.
Yeah.
They looked around and, you
it's
know.
It supports your lung to heal.
That's, you know, well, see, I don't know anything, but you do. Good.
Praise God.
But anyway, he is doing better, and the only thing I can say is he's got to be coming through this. He's been a young man that really is a fine Christian from what I've seen. He was actually preaching out at River Woods.
Oh.
The church that I don't think it's owned by the Sun Baptist anymore, but he's been preaching out there and going out there.
Recently?
Recently?
Oh, good.
Well, in the last 6 months.
Good. You know, so after it was sold, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, after it was sold, so.
Okay. So let's pray for Jonathan Van Bleed in Washington. He's in the hospital with COVID. Let's continue to pray for LB's ministry to his coworkers. That's a strong ministry he has. Anything else?
Yes.
Yes.
My friend Fran is going to have brain surgery on the 2nd of June. It's very complicated.
Brain surgery for Fran.
Here.
Dr. Teams.
Okay. Anything else?
I think we should praise God for the rain.
Yes.
Yes. It's nice to have some rain. Yes. Gave me an excuse to do not much yesterday. First time in a while. Anything else? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come to you and we submit our lives to you, expecting great things from you when we worship, Lord. We can see you more clearly. We ask your blessing be upon all of those that we've mentioned by name. We begin with those suffering from cancer, Lord, and struggling with it for long term. We remember those in our congregation for Jim Kraft. We ask that you would continue to sustain him as he deals with the effects of chemotherapy. And for Tracy, we pray that you continue to work with her and heal her from her renal cell cancer, and pray that you might continue to help her to function fully as she has been with just this medication. Lord, we're grateful that it has not spread beyond where it is. Pray that that will continue to be the case. Father, we also pray your blessing upon all those that we've mentioned that have this long battle with cancer, for David Winters and Michelle Smith, Francis Mulliner, Lulu Kelly, who is on hospice care, Jim Kraft, Marlene and Terry Rennie, Beth Barnes and David Winters. We remember them all and ask your blessing upon them. We pray specifically, Lord, for our friend Dee Dee, who has been dealing with COVID now for months, and we pray that you would strengthen her now that the symptoms have abated and she seems to be over the immediate danger of COVID bother, but she is feeling still very weak and lethargic, and pray that you would restore her energy, that she might be able to use her energy to regain her strength and strengthen her muscles, and her body might bounce back from COVID. We pray that there might be a true peace in their home as they've been struggling now for quite some time, and pray for her sister and her mom too, Joanne and Terry, that they might all be strengthened and be able to come back soon to join us. We thank you, Father, for the work that our friends are doing outside on the church facility. We realize the church is not a building, but Father, we also recognize that you've given us this facility and we want to be good stewards, and we're excited for the way that the building is being updated and improved and made safer, and we pray that you would help us to be good stewards and do the continued work to keep this place in good shape, to do the ministry that you've called us to do, as well as others to meet here and to use this facility to bless others. Father, we pray for Marlis Coonrod as she continues to recover from her foot and back surgery. We pray for Jody Hayward with her back and her heart concerns. We pray for my friend Joyce Sibley, and who's like a mother to me, and I just pray that you would strengthen her and encourage her. And if there's any confusion there, I pray that you'd help her to be clear in her understanding. She's always been so smart, and I just pray that you would help her as she deals with the loss of her coherent, brilliant mind that you've given her. But Lord, I also know that she has a tremendous faith and a great comfort in your presence, and we pray that you'd strengthen her and bless her. Father, I pray for all those that are on our list and continue to struggle with COVID. This one that we've just heard from about Jonathan Van Bleed in Washington, pray that you would strengthen him and help cope LB to minister to his co-workers, and we thank you for his ministry. Father, we pray for Kathy's friend Fran, who's dealing with this upcoming brain surgery. Pray that you would give her a successful surgery and come back to full strength soon, you know, strong recovery. Father, we celebrate today our friend Raphael, who we've not even met, but Frank's grandson, who is now walking free for the first time in many years. Pray that you would inspire him to use his freedom for your glory and not for his own. Pray that you'd help him to find the right mentors and leadership to live a new life, that he would never, ever struggle again in a way that he might have to go back to prison. And pray that you would help him and his family as they learn to move forward in life, and pray that Frank might be able to minister to his grandson. And we, Father, have a special interest in wanting him to come here and to join Frank in his home, and pray that you might guide him this way, if that be your will. Father, we remember Lenora Sparks as she recovers. Pray that you continue to be with her, and thank you for sparing her life. Father, we pray for Tracy and this cancer treatment. Pray for all those, Father, that are on our list, that they would continue to be blessed. And finally, for Rachel and Stephen, we pray that you might encourage them and give them very clear vision, Father, for what you want them to do. Now, Lord, all these things we ask in your name, and we celebrate with our tithes and offerings in worship today by giving them to you. May we use them as you intended. In Jesus' name, amen. God is who. Fill me with thy divine. take down my heart, cleanse every part. Holy Spirit, breathe on me. Holy Spirit, breathe on me. Show us what you want us to see today. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to spend a few weeks in John chapter 3 discussing what it means to be born again. Nicodemus, of course, was a Pharisee, it says, that seemed to be a little bit more thoughtful than most of the Pharisees. I don't know if you caught on to this pattern in Scripture, but most of the time that the Pharisees were listening to Jesus, they weren't really interested in what he had to say as much as they were interested in trying to trap him into making a mistake that they could then accuse him of something bad. We like to think that our culture invents everything. Well, we are in the middle of cancel culture. It started a long time ago. Cancel culture, what is that? It's when someone makes perhaps a minor mistake, and then some people who oppose them use that to pummel them in the media and just over and over again make them sound like a horrible person. In just a few weeks, their whole life has been boiled down to this one small thing that they said, and they are demonized and vilified and mocked out of the public square. That's called cancel culture. They have a new thing in our culture that has been invented. And it's selectively used because it has no basis in reality. It is selectively used because, folks, there are a whole lot of people that do a whole lot of weird things and bad things when nobody's looking. And sometimes that comes out. We don't talk about that. We don't want to embarrass anyone in particular. This is not about us trying to seize on any one person's mistakes. But there are people who have made grievous errors in the way men who have treated women of the opposite sex with disrespect. And mainly I'm talking about sexual harassment and inappropriate advances, that kind of thing. We had a senator in Oregon 30 years ago who had an incident where he was drummed out of office because he had made some very inappropriate comments or gestures to other people. He kissed a couple of people that he shouldn't have. But as sexual scandals go, it's pretty mild. At the same time, there was another person who was a notorious womanizer that everyone seemed to say, I don't see anything. I can't see it. This is the way the Pharisees were trying to treat Jesus. He did something wrong. We don't know what it is yet, but we'll find it. That's what they're doing to our former President Trump in New York right now. They've got an investigation. You ask them, what are you investigating? We don't know yet, but we'll find it. Yeah. Well, that's not supposed to be how investigations work. You're supposed to know something went wrong that you need to check out further, and then you get evidence and you take it. Well, that's not what happens in reality. In reality, we try to destroy people that we are politically opposed to based on a few things. Brett Kavanaugh, Clarence Thomas, 30 years ago, who was treated so shabbily. A great, good American guy who rose up from a sharecropping farm to the Supreme Court nomination, and he was almost drummed out on some very flimsy charges. Well, they tried to do it again a couple of years ago to Brett Kavanaugh, who seemed to live a pretty good life. Had he made some mistakes? Sure, everybody does. He drank too much when he was younger. But that hardly disqualifies you from public service, or we would have no politicians. The hardest thing about Clarence Thomas, he said, sitting in that Senate chamber as they discussed his entire life, as it boiled down to the suggested more innuendo than anything of one person, the hardest thing for him was, he said, to sit and be judged by men he knew to be of scandalous character. That's the irony, is if you want to serve, you've got to go before people that cannot carry one drop of water in their integrity bucket, because it's got holes in it. And yet they sit in judgment of others. This is the Pharisees. They had no business trying to judge anyone else. Who were they to question Jesus? And yet over and over again, they came to him and said, "We have a question for you." They would sit around thinking up questions. What can we do to get him? Let's ask him about divorce and remarriage. In Matthew, they said, "Jesus, suppose a man who divorces his wife, can you divorce a woman for any cause at all?" Jesus said, "God lets you divorce people because of your hard hearts." He immediately took the focus off the legal terminology and turned it to what was inside of them and said, "Something's wrong with your heart if you can't see what divorce is about." It's not about divorce and remarriage and the legal technicalities of the law. Y'all focus on stuff that just isn't important. What's important is what's going on inside of you right this minute. The hardness of your heart. Another time they tried to trick him and say, if a man dies and his brother does the traditional cultural thing and his brother marries that woman, when they get to heaven, whose wife is she going to be? We got him now. Then they said, "Hey, next time we see a woman in adultery, come let us know. We'll go grab her and we'll take her before Jesus." They didn't care about adultery, just like our politicians today don't care about adultery. In fact, most of them enjoy adultery. They celebrate it. They live it. Most of them couldn't care less about it, except when it gives them some leverage over a political opponent. We've got a governor right now who's been accused by 20 times more people than Brett Kavanaugh was. And yet, that whole media establishment is quiet. The man that was too risky to allow to go forward on the Supreme Court, something 20 times worse is going on in New York, and they won't say a word about it. They won't say that man's got to get out. The governor of Virginia was found to have put on black makeup and imitated blackface, done blackface in his yearbook picture. And all of a sudden, that wasn't such a big problem for his political allies. So we don't know how people want to destroy us until it comes. That's what cancel culture is all about. Cancel culture surrounded Jesus. Everyone wanted to cancel him and say, "Get this guy out of here. We don't care whether he's a false prophet or not, but if we can get people to think he is, that helps us. People will start listening to us again." Right now, when we go to speak at the temple, he's got hundreds of people and we got two or three. Nobody wants to listen to us. That's not right. Who is this guy? Who trained him? Where did he get his education? They started doing background checks on Jesus. Jewish Secret Service officers went to Joseph's carpentry shop. How long was Jesus employed here? Did you ever see anything un-Jewish about him? They asked his neighbors, what do you know? You got any good dirt on him? Of course they don't. How boring would it be for someone doing investigation on Jesus to try to find dirt? The only man who ever lived who ain't got no dirt. What a lousy job that would be to be his background check FBI agent. Man, are you sure he didn't do anything wrong? He talked to the teachers and he said, like, did he ever cheat? No. Did he ever fill out a bad time card, Joseph? And so they stood in front of him time after time trying to trick him. And finally they had a woman in front of him. He said, we got him this time, man. We got him. We got him. Because he preaches love and he's going to say, the law says to stone her. He can't answer this without making a mistake. And Jesus said, you're right. The law says to stone her. So the sinless one among you, pick up the first stone and you throw it. And they all looked at each other and said, didn't think of that. That's a good answer. Who's going to throw it? Bob, you throw it. Nope, I can't do it. I can't stand there and say I'm sinless. Jesus went straight to the heart of darkness standing before him and said, if you're sinless, you throw it. He challenged the heart every time. Why did he do that? How did he know to go to the hearts of the Pharisees, rather than trying to argue the jots and the tittles of the legal argument? Jesus said, what's going on inside of you? What's going on inside of you? And that's the question I'm going to ask today. What's going on inside of you? Not from an accusatory place, just saying, is anything going on? You see, Jesus, you see how every time Jesus would turn it inward to where they were living, because he knew their hearts were dark. They could not see the light. They could not see the truth. They claim to worship God. Over and over again, they say, God is our salvation. We take money to the temple. We pray regularly. We stand on the street corners and do it so everybody knows we're good people. It's kind of like putting a sign in your front yard. Have you seen some of those signs around town? It says, we believe this, we believe that. I want to go around town and in every one of those yards says, self-righteousness alert. You put a sign in your yard saying, here's what I believe, I'm a good person. Folks, don't tell me about it. Show me. I don't want to hear it. I want to see it. Telling people, I mean, I encourage you, if you have enough money to get a billboard and say what a good person you are, I encourage you to rethink that strategy of life. But that's what people are doing these days. They want to put a sign out in their yard that says, I believe this and that. I'm a good person. I got a sign in my yard. That don't mean anything. Yeah. Signs mean nothing. Words mean nothing. What do you do with your life? That means something. And Jesus stood there in front of that woman and said, I do not condemn you. After going to the heart of the Pharisees, he turned to the woman and went straight into her heart. You see how he did that? He went straight to the heart of who they were. He didn't care about what they said or what they did. He went inside and said, what's going on inside of you? You aren't where you need to be in life, but I don't condemn you for that. I understand it. But now you need to go and you need to live a different way because that's what would be best for you. And she walked away shaken. She came that close to death. Folks, she was sitting on the ground. You ever think of that woman? She was that far away. She knew she was about to die in the worst possible way by stoning. And Jesus changed everything by going straight to the heart, first of her accusers and then to her. And where did he come from? He came from his own heart. There was a way of a vision that Jesus had that we just don't have. He can see things that we don't see. I got to see Wayne Gretzky play hockey one time. Wayne Gretzky was coming to, when he was with the New York Rangers. He was playing with the Rangers in the latter part of his career, and he was coming to the Washington Capitals arena in Washington, D.C., and I got to see him play hockey. And a friend of ours was a hockey goalie, and he says, "Pastor, I'd love to take you with me to go see a hockey game." And I said, "Man, that sounds interesting, except I don't like hockey." He says, "Oh, you'll like it." And he was right, man. It was cool. It was cool. I had no idea how fast those guys are and how strong they are and how hard they hit and how fast they hit the puck. I mean, it was fascinating. I went to several more games after that. I haven't been to a hockey game since because Bend, Oregon ain't big on hockey.
It's getting better.
Is it? Okay.
Yes, it is.
But it was an exciting night. But most of all, I got to see a legend play. It's the only legend I ever got to see play besides Jerry Rice when I got to see him play down in San Francisco. He was my idol. Him and Steve Largent were my idols, Jerry Rice and Steve Largent. But I got to see Wayne Gretzky play hockey. Now, if you're going to go to one hockey game, go into a game with Wayne Gretzky, and it is the one you want to go to. Why? He's not flashy. He's not fancy. He's not doing circles and jumping over people. He's just smart. And what they always said, if you look it up, what they will say about Wayne Gretzky is, he did it so quietly. He would score over and over again, and yet it wasn't fancy. He just did it well. And if they asked Wayne Gretzky, he would say, "You know, I think," they would say, "What makes you so great?" And, you know, how do you answer that?
"Well, I just guess it's just natural, you know."
What do you say when somebody says, "How are you so great at what you do?" He said, "I can see things, I think." I've thought about this a long time. He said this after he was retired. "I can see things before other people can see them on a hockey rink in the ice. I could just see things unfolding. And sometimes I'd see it, it was almost like as a premonition. I could see this guy's going to go this way, this guy's going to go." And my brain worked fast enough where I could put it together what was happening. And he could make a pass before a guy would cut. And guy would come in and everybody said, "Why is he passing it there?" And then the guy would swoop in and come in and backhand a goal right in there. Half of his goals were scored not by him, but by others, assisting others. Because he was so smart, he could just make stuff happen. He could see things that other people couldn't see. A lot of the great athletes are that way. They could just see stuff. A lot of people talk about Michael Jordan that way, LeBron. LeBron's a great, everybody talk about how great an athlete he is. I don't like him, but he's a great basketball player. He's never played for teams I like, so I've always, I was kind of like that way with Michael Jordan too. But boy, LeBron can see stuff that other people can't see. He's not great because he's big and strong and fast. He's great because he can make plays that others can't see. Being big and strong and fast makes him greater. But he's a great basketball player. Even if I don't like him, I can recognize, man, that guy's good. One of the best that ever lived. Now, if you take that and apply that to your faith, can you see things that other people can't see? Nope. That's what most of us say, nope. In fact, I can't see nothing. It's almost like I wander through my Christian life with blinders on, and yet the Bible talks over and over again. It says, you can see this if you look for it. If you see it with a vision that God gives you, you can put it together and you can change things. It's how you look at something. It's being able to see something before it happens, being able to understand what's about to happen. Do you have that kind of vision? Jesus had it. I think it has something to do with the heart. Knowing people's hearts. Jesus could cut to the quick of a person. The woman at the well found out that Jesus could see what was going on inside of her. He went to her heart. And she says, "I perceive you may be a prophet. Something's different about you." Now, I don't want you all to try to go out and be prophetic. I don't want you all to go out and try to impress people with your knowledge. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about just the everyday Christian life of being able to see something that God wants you to see. Because there's all kinds of things that we think we see that aren't real. We could give a lot of for instances. We could see, I was watching something the other day, and I get mad when I see crime going on. Right now, there's a pandemic going on in our country, and it ain't COVID. young people stealing cars and going crazy on highways and stuff. In Miami the other day, 5 kids stole a car, 16 and under. 2 12-year-olds, a 14-year-old, and 2 16-year-olds stole a car, almost killed a bicyclist, and then went on the highway over 100 miles an hour. Folks, I'm a decent driver, and I'm going to kill somebody if I do that. A 16-year-old that can barely drive. You're endangering hundreds, and I get mad about that. I get mad. Where's the parents? I get mad. But then I think, okay, that's my first rant of the day. Let's get out of rant mode and go to heart mode. What is going on in a person that at 16 years old, you could go out and endanger the lives of others just so you could get some kicks? And I remember being in San Francisco in the projects one day, driving along in my truck, and I heard a bunch of boys laughing and stuff. And as I was driving forward, I had my window down on this side, and I heard them laughing, and I didn't notice on this side there's some other boys, and somebody threw a brick or a bottle or something at my window, and it just shattered and went all over me and cut my face up. And I mean, I just was covered in glass and blood, and I was just like, holy cow. I just working, man. I didn't do anything wrong. I was driving at night trying to make my deliveries and somebody trying to hurt me. And I hear boys laughing as they run off. And I got out and I got mad. And I started yelling. But then I said, I better get out of here. And I drove on down the road and I was mad. I got out of my truck. I started stomping. And then all of a sudden I had a change of heart because I started to cry. I began to weep a little bit. And I just thought, man, those kids don't have a chance. They think this is entertainment. They can't see that this is going to lead to bad stuff. It's going to lead to worse stuff. And I felt just suddenly, I just felt overwhelmed with that sense that some people, the way they grow up and where they grow up, means that they just don't have much of a chance to see anything better. You see the difference? I was mad, and then I was compassionate within 30 seconds. What's that about? I believe that's what God can do for us. He can take anger and turn it into compassion by giving us vision. When we see what is going on in the hearts of children, are you going to say those children are evil? Can you do that? I can't. Children aren't evil. God doesn't create evil children. They do stupid stuff. Chief among sinners right here. Okay? I could tell you some of the stupid stuff and you'd go, why did you do that? I said, I don't know. I used to hear about cow tipping. So let's go tip some cows. Those cows didn't want to be tipped. They didn't want to be tipped. I got run over by a big fat cow because I tried. They're not cooperating. I started reading. How do you tip a cow? I never learned how to tip a cow. Well, that's dumb. Why do it? I don't know. I wasn't evil. I wasn't trying to hurt a farmer. I wasn't hating cows. I love cows. I love to eat them. I certainly know this. I was not evil, but I did some dumb things. The children that tried to assault me that night were not evil. They did something stupid. You could even say they did something evil, but you cannot say they are evil. And you can only see that if you get beyond your anger, which may or may not be deep in your heart, and you can move into compassion. And the only way to do that is to have the vision of what those kids are coming from. I'm not trying to excuse crime of kids. No, if they do the crime, they got to do the time. I hope those kids go to juvenile hall and get straightened out. But they're not evil. The heart of man is not evil. It is full of sin. It is full of darkness. And so were you. And there, but by the grace of God, go me and you. I don't know how I'm not in prison today. I can honestly say that to you. I do not know. Except for the Word of God, I don't know. because I should not have survived to adulthood, and having survived to adulthood, I should not have been allowed to roam free. But somehow, by God's grace, I was able to be a functional adult despite some difficult things. But I know this, what you can see is not always reality. If you're one of those get off my lawn kind of guys, you're not seeing things from God's perspective. If you're angry and you're ranting all the time, guilty. You know what I've been doing lately? I've been stopping myself almost pre-rant. I will rant for about 5 seconds and go, that's a rant, and I'll stop myself. Because ranting is not productive. My poor wife has had to suffer through endless rants. In fact, look at her. She's like, yes, God deliver me. Because I can rant to her. I don't rant to everybody else. Because that doesn't look good on preachers. But I'll rant to her. Poor gal. But I got to get it off my chest is what it feels like. But that's not really my heart. You see, I got out ready to rant when those boys broke my window in my truck trying to hurt me. And they just thought it was funny. I got out mad and I was ready to rant. But when I got down the road a little bit and I got out, it turned to pain. I felt the pain of those boys. This is what they do for fun. They didn't know me. They weren't trying to hurt me. They were just bored. Whatever. I don't know what it was. I never met them. I never even saw them. I heard them. But I know this. What God had done in my life by keeping me out of prison suddenly came to my mind. I was able to see myself in them, and I knew I wasn't evil, but I felt, well, they can't be either. Boy, they don't have a shot. They're living poor. They don't have anybody as a better example. They think this is fun. I just had to lick my wounds and go on down the street, fix my window, and get over it. I had no other choice. There was no justice. There was no, nothing was made right. There's no good ending to the story, except God showed me that I can be angry and furious even, and yet, within the same moment, be compassionate. You have that access to compassion and love, even in your darkest moment, because God is in you. If you allow Him to work in you, He will allow the right stuff to come forward. Anger lives way closer to the surface than love. And it covers over love. Compassion is covered over by frustration and bitterness. But underneath it all is the love of God in your pure new heart. Jesus got to the heart of people. Nicodemus' story is in John chapter 3. Turn there if you will. While you're turning, what we're going to look at real quick, it's not going to be a long sermon today. We're going to look at three quick points. Clearer vision will follow your rebirth. You will gain the ability to see things more clearly. Reality will become easier for you to discover. Clearer vision. I didn't put clear, clearer. In other words, you'll be able to see things you didn't see before. It doesn't mean you can see everything. It just means that with a pure heart comes the ability to see things differently. Secondly, how you see reveals what you see. And third, how you see reveals who you will see. I wanted to begin with this guy. He has done written many books and works with families with autistic children. Barry Neal Kaufman opened an autism center, and he did a lot of study with autistic children and saw that they see the world differently than we see the world. And I've told you about this guy before, but there is a African-American guy that was on 60 Minutes who has the ability to see something just briefly, and he is able to draw in great detail in entire cityscape. I think I mentioned this a few months ago. I don't remember his name, but he was flown by 60 Minutes. They hired a helicopter to fly over the city of Rome with this autistic young black man in the looking out the window of the helicopter. He was autistic, meaning he was struggles to have any kind of clear communication with people. He struggles to read social cues. Depending on the severity that you are autistic on the spectrum, sometimes you can barely communicate at all. My wife has worked with a lot of autistic kids, and autistic kids can be incredibly warm and engaging, and at the same time, they can be very frustratingly distant. It's hard to reach them. If you've had trouble reaching your own kid, you know how frustrating that can be. And he said, the way we choose to see the world creates the world we see. The way we choose to see the world. Now, I agree with part of this, and I disagree with another part. But I wanted to use it to show you that the way we see the world can change. The first thing I disagree with, we don't often choose to see the world in a certain way. We just see it. It's not a conscious choice. But over time, if we are really focused and mindful of it and we work hard to concentrate, we can realize that we do choose to see things in a certain way. And it's hard to let go of seeing things in a certain way. If your father was a certain way when you were a kid, you've seen your father in a certain way your whole life. That was my case, of course. My case was I saw my father in a very, very bad light for most of my life. He was very, very, we had a lot of enmity, let's just say it that way, between us. In fact, there was a lot of trauma that went on and that I carried for many years. And I saw him in a light that was not flattering to him. In fact, there was a period of my life I did not want to ever see him again or talk to him again. I thought I might not. And I knew, being in ministry, that was not possible. I was faced with a choice. I have to deal with that or I have to leave ministry because I cannot live with this kind of bitterness toward my own father. It's just obviously not right. And I went through a process of forgiveness that took many years, but eventually I had a therapist that helped me learn to forgive my father. It didn't fix everything, but I learned to be able to communicate with him so that I had a respectful relationship for the last 20 years of my father's life. We had no cross words together. I was able to show him respect, but at the same time, I was able to set some boundaries with him and said, that ain't gonna work with me anymore. I had to be a man with him. But eventually, I came to have a genuine love for him, which I never thought was possible. And when he died, I was sad. But when I was at his funeral, some things were said about my dad being a great man and the most compassionate man. Other people had stood up and said this kind of stuff. And I looked at my brother and sister and said, who are they talking about? But that was true. If you didn't grow up in his house, you probably saw him as a very kind, compassionate, and long-suffering servant who wanted to help people. Now, if you grew up in his house, he was just a jerk who didn't like his kids. But you see, the way I chose to see, now I didn't know I was making a choice, but I didn't even know it was an option to look at him differently until I did the work of forgiveness, and then I could look at him differently. I chose to do the work of forgiveness, which helped me to see him in a different light, so that now when I describe my father, I describe him in more of a mosaic, that my father had a really dark side that came out of his own woundedness. He didn't even know about it. I don't believe when he started abusing me as a child, he didn't even know about it. But he also had a part of him that was an incredibly authentic servant who wanted to serve the Lord and do nothing but help others. And he did that for the last part of his life. He did it well. Both things are true about him. Both things. So it's not accurate what I saw. You see what I'm saying? I chose to see that. It's all I could see, really, at the time. But when I had an opportunity to choose something different, I chose to see him differently. Not directly, I chose to go through the process of forgiveness, and it allowed me to see him differently. You see how that works? That's where the choice comes from. You can choose to walk in bitterness, or you can choose to say, is there something better? That was a tough road for me. But the second part I disagree with in this statement, it doesn't create the world you see. It seems to create the world you see. It doesn't create any world. It just simply changes the way you operate in the world. It doesn't create any world. Nothing is created. God created the world. God created reality. There are not multiple places of reality. God made what's real. And it's our job to find out the truth and see what is real. Now, it seemed real to me that my father was evil, that my father was abusive and he didn't deserve to walk free. For a time, I thought maybe I can get my dad prosecuted for what he did to us. I'm glad I didn't. What a dead end that would have been. Wouldn't have healed anything. Wouldn't have brought any healing at all. It would have just delayed my vision of compassion and forgiveness. But it doesn't create the world. The world, the way we choose to see the world, doesn't create the world. It simply can limit your experience of the truth. It can limit your experience of reality. I believe that is at the heart of what Jesus is talking about in John chapter 3 when he says you must be born again. I believe we're going to get to that very quickly when we see Jesus talk about seeing clearly. So let's jump on that first point. Clearer vision will follow your rebirth. When you are born again, you will have clearer vision. And Nicodemus' story begins in verse 1. Now there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus. He was not your normal Pharisee. He was not part of cancel culture. He thought, these guys are idiots, but they're my brother Pharisees, so I got to kind of maybe try to help him out. I'll go see for myself who this Jesus is. He was more thoughtful than most of the Pharisees. He didn't want to just be self-righteous and cancel Jesus just because he disagreed with him. He heard too many good things about Jesus for him to just go and dismiss Jesus. He wanted to know the truth. He was seeking Jesus. And Jesus could sense that. So there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, Rabbi, we know that you have come from God as a teacher. So first of all, he came to him by night. That means he didn't really want people to know he was talking to Jesus. Because the second he walked out of there, if the Pharisees saw that, say, did you get any dirt? He wasn't there for dirt. He was there for the truth. And he had a very interesting opening line. We know that you have come from God. Who's we? The Pharisees. The Pharisees knew this man that they were trying to destroy was not your average guy. We know he's from God. We don't understand it. We can't see how he's from God. We just know that there's something to this guy. You don't heal people and raise them from the dead and give sight to the blind and heal people's lifelong crippling ailments and come up with the answers that befuddle the most learned people in Israel with very little education. We know you have come from God. He said, I know your context. Something about you tells me you are not just an ordinary guy. You are not an ordinary political opponent. We can't cancel you like we've done to all our other opponents. And you get the sense that Nicodemus doesn't even want to try to do that. He says, I want to know what's going on here. And so he says to him, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him. He says, I'm convinced. I have bought into what's going on here. You are who you say you are. I believe that. Help me understand. And Jesus said something very interesting. He said, Jesus answered and said to him, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Now, what does that have to do with what Nicodemus just asked? Well, he didn't even ask a question. He just made a statement. He says, I know you're from God. And Jesus said, I tell you the truth. Unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God, much less God himself. Unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. I don't know if you've ever looked at this, but as I was studying this passage, the words, he cannot see the kingdom of God, jumped out to me. He cannot see the kingdom of God. And I went over that and it began to spin around in my heart and my mind. And it took me back to standing on the side of the road in San Francisco in the projects and how God gave me clear vision in just a moment. Right after I was ready to scob some knobs. I don't know if you know that term. In Oklahoma, if you got, yeah, you got like somebody scob your knob. I was ready to scob some knobs right there. Break my window and try to throw something at my face. I'm just a working man out here trying to make a living. You're throwing stuff at me. I didn't do anything to you. And within 30 seconds, I had a vision of something different. Unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. But if you are born again, you can see it. You can see something that others can't see. What limits our vision? What limits what we see? What keeps us from seeing what God wants us to see? I mean, have you ever thought of that? How many times have you been this close to a gold nugget walking in the wilderness and didn't see it? I hope God shows me that someday. Look, if you'd have just bent down right at that moment, you could have bought a new truck. How many times have we missed something? How many times have we not seen something that God wanted us to see? And the answer is every day. You see, God has given you opportunities you missed throughout your life. He's given you people that needed your touch, that He prepared and you missed it. I don't want to miss that. What do I have to do to get clearer vision? I've already been born again in the spiritual sense. God has changed my heart. He has put a pure heart within me. It's there. Why can't I see? Because my vision is only clearer. It's not clear. If you want to put it on hearing, I always tell people, I can hear God's voice occasionally, but most of the time it's just noise in my head. I don't have peace because of that noise. I can't see the kingdom of God as I want to see it. I can't sense God's presence next to me sometimes. Does that sound familiar to you? We know that God is there. Ask Frank. He was there for every week of Job. When we studied Job, we learned Job found out at the end God was with him every second of that journey. Even when it felt like he wasn't there. Folks, that's the message after 9 months of studying Job. You and I learned that the message of Job is that God is with you whether you see him or not. Why don't we see him? Only occasionally do we feel him. But he's there. Why would we think he's not? Why do we say, God, I can't find you. Where'd you go? I'm right behind you. I'm right inside you. I'm right with you. But you can't hear him either. But if we are born again, it says we can. Why don't we? We're going to look at that for the next few weeks and say, what is clouding our vision? What is keeping us from seeing what God has already prepared for us? What is keeping us from taking the next step in our Christian journey? What is keeping us from seeing the true nature of the heart of those around us? They're not evil. Even those people that you hate on TV, even those political opponents you hate, even those people who did you wrong are not evil. They are lost. Evil can live in the hearts of men, but men aren't evil. Every single human being has within them the ability to be redeemed because God is who He is. Not because they're good people, not because they make good choices, but because God is who He is. Everyone is redeemable. Therefore, there is no one who is not a child of God. We don't need to demonize people that we don't agree with, or people that hurt us. Because when we demonize people, all we're doing is we are taking ourselves farther and farther away from the reality that God wants us to see. And that is that He can minister to the heart of anyone who will open the door to Him. And if you think people are evil, you'll say, well, God isn't working on that guy. And I'm kind of happy about that. Burn in hell, sinner. Ever feel that way? Wow. I can't wait for judgment day for that guy. You will find no comfort in the judgment of any other human being. There will be no comfort for you. You won't stand by and go, yes. In fact, if you're standing there at the judgment, you will weep for the loss of that soul into the pit of hell. God loves every one of those lost souls. Why don't we? Because we cannot see as God sees. What would happen to us if we could see ourselves and others as God sees us? What would we see? What would you see? Would you see a pure heart that God has built and constructed and placed within that person? Or would you just see another lazy Christian? Would you see someone who had been deeply wounded many years ago and is struggling to overcome? Or would you just see somebody who won't let go of hatred? Bitterness. That's what I used to think about my sister. I'd get off the phone and shake my head. She is just so bitter. Golly, frustrate me. What I see now is how much regret I have that I could not see the pain that she was in. It tears at me every day. It's my biggest regret in life is that I could not help her when I could. I want to go down there. I just want to hold her and say, I wish I could have seen it. I wish I could have got you help. I wish I could have done more then. I couldn't see it. Why? Because I couldn't see it in myself either. I couldn't see it. In this whole thing of vision, it has come to me that I was driving toward Redmond one day when all those memories came back after 45 years of being gone. 45 years, I couldn't see it. And all of a sudden I could see it. And I was like, finally I can get better. You know what? I didn't. It didn't get better. It got worse before it got better. Seeing that stuff didn't help at all. It was just the next step in the journey to get it off the books so I could start dealing with the real stuff. It took the mystery out of what had happened. I could finally see it, but it didn't heal. It just simply helped me to move on to the next chapter. Say, okay, now I can see it. What's next? Because it didn't fix me. It didn't make me happier. It didn't make me any less lighthearted, or it didn't heal me. It didn't do anything. You'd think, wow, if I could just see it. That's what I thought all those years. If I could just see it, I'd feel better. Nope. The hard work began is all it meant. The hard work began. I'm still doing that hard work. And I still can't see the kingdom of God as I believe God wants me to see it. I've been born again, have you? Can you see the kingdom of God? Can you see what God wants you to do in that kingdom? Can you see what he wants you to do with the people in it? Can you see it? Why not? It's time to ask, why can't I see clearly? What's keeping my vision blocked? I'm going to say this. I do agree with Mr. Kaufman, who we just read his quote earlier. We do choose to stay here in a place where we can't see. We choose to walk in darkness. It may not be a conscious choice, but it is a choice. You have to literally work and work and work to stop the habit of walking in darkness and seeing everything the same way you've always seen it. It was a tough habit for me to give up seeing my father in a bad light only. I still see him. I still see the darkness. I didn't ever give that up. I still see that. It was bad. I'm telling you, it was bad. He'd be in prison today. If he did today what he did then, he'd be in prison. So I never stopped seeing that, but I had to start seeing something else. I didn't say excuse anything he did. I just said, I can see now. I can see another side, that it's more than just him being angry or hating me, which is what I always thought. He just hated me for some reason. That's not true. He hated himself. I couldn't see it. I couldn't see it because all I could feel were the blows that he would rain down. You don't care why somebody's doing that to you. You don't care why. You just want it to stop. But the vision changes everything. If you can see what's going on behind the scenes, it changes everything. Jesus says, I need you to understand that unless you are born again, Nicodemus, you cannot see the kingdom of God. And even if you are born again, it can be hard to see. It's not crystal clear, folks. I've been doing this a long time and I still struggle to see the kingdom of God. It's getting clearer. It's getting better. I can see it more. I can see the opportunities that I miss and take care of it ahead of time. I can now see what's most important in my life. I can see things that I need to pay attention to that person when they have an open window of opportunity with me. And when that window opens with my child, I can say the same thing. When that window's open, I need to go through it. I need to drop what I'm doing and focus. Doesn't mean I get it every time. It just means that I can see it more clearly when it does happen sometimes. Unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And how you see reveals what you see. How you see this world will reveal what you see. It will show certain things by how you see things. If you choose to look at the world through bitterness, you will see the world in a certain way. If you choose to pursue forgiveness and love, you'll see it differently. You really will. It looks different. Now, that doesn't say, folks, people, my sister did not choose to be bitter consciously all those years. See, she had to watch what happened in our home. It didn't happen to her but once, but she had to watch it over and over again, and she was very traumatized by that. It's worse when it happens to someone you love than when it happens to you. And she didn't want to be bitter. She didn't think she had a choice. It's all she could see. It's all she could see. If you choose to see the world in a certain way, it will reveal what you see. How you see reveals what you see. And here's what I mean by that. Let's read Matthew chapter 6. This is in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount. We're going to look at two passages in the Sermon on the Mount today. First, Matthew 6, verse 22. The eye is the lamp of the body. This comes right after Jesus has been talking about money. And wherever your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Do not store up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy, where thieves can break in and steal. But store up for yourself treasures in heaven where moth and rust cannot destroy, and thieves cannot break in and steal. For wherever your treasure is, there your heart will be. And then he says, the eye is the lamp of the body. This is a very interesting passage. I have struggled with this passage most of my ministry. I usually give some kind of lame interpretation of it. I've read all kinds of commentaries on it, but I believe I understand it a lot more clearly now. I'm not saying I get it all, but it's as all of Jesus' teaching, there are multiple layers of truth revealed, and you see it differently as you grow. You see, I see the story of the prodigal son differently every decade of my life. I've seen it differently. When I was young, I identified with the son that ran off and blew his money. I didn't go out and blow my money. I just lived like an idiot for a while. I identified with that kid. And I didn't identify with him because I didn't have a dad like that. But I really identified with that guy. Well, later, I identified with the second son who was saying, here, I did all this good stuff and I'm a good person, and you kill the fatted calf for him. You never killed the fatted calf for me. What am I, chopped liver? I identified with that son for a while. Then I identified with the father for a while. When you have children, you realize the heart is deep with forgiveness. You'll do a lot to make your child to make their life better. I've been working night and day. I've been telling you about on the project out here and working in my shop, but also work at my daughter's house. My daughter is like, Dad, don't come over anymore. You don't have time to do this. And I don't, but you know what I want to do? I want to go over and work on her house. That's what I'd rather do. I'd rather do that than make money and support my family. Sorry, honey. I'd rather do that than go out there and work on the front of the church with an excavator. Sorry, church. I would rather go and help my child. Because I see the prodigal son story more in the eyes of the father who just wants his child to have a good life. That's how the scripture works. Every time we change and every time we grow into a new season of life, we can see something different in the Word of God. This is exactly true with what Jesus says in this passage. I couldn't see what he's saying. Now I think I can see it more clearly. I still don't understand it all. I might not understand all of it till I stand before the Lord. But right here he says, the eye is the lamp of the body. Now, just think about that. The eye is the lamp. It means a lamp is what you carry in the darkness to reveal something that is hidden by the darkness. The lamp gives you the ability to see. So he says, the eye reveals what other people cannot see in the darkness. The eye is the lamp of the body. Your body would be in darkness. You'd be going like this if you can't see. But your eye is like a lamp. You're not just wandering around in the darkness. You're holding the light up. And wherever you take that light, you can see the way things are. The eye is the lamp of the body. So then, if your eye is clear, your whole body will be full of light. That's a promise, men and women of God. If your eye is clear, your whole body will be full of light. Now, if that doesn't give you a little tingle up your spine, I don't know what church you're going to, but that makes me feel Pentecostal a little bit. I can feel something when I read that. If your eye is clear, your whole body will be full of light. That sounds a lot better than the stuff I've had in my body most of my life. If your eye is clear, that is motivation to see what is clouding your vision, what is in your eye, what is keeping your eye from clarity, what is keeping it from focusing. Have you ever scratched your eye and then for days you're just like, oh, and it's watering and it's just sore and you can't see anything clearly? It just has to have time to heal. There's a good metaphor for you. If you can't see clearly, you need time to heal. You need time to work on getting something out of your eye. Shortly after this verse, Jesus begins to talk about the log in your eye. In chapter 7, verses 5, 6, and 7, he says, why do you see the speck that is in your brother's eye, but you can't see the log that is in your own eye? You just got this little tiny splinter, and you're tripping over yourself to run over there and say, look at that speck. In the meantime, you got this big old log right in your face, and you can't see anything because all you're concerned about is that guy's righteousness instead of your own heart. The log in your own eye will keep you from seeing something. Jesus says, that's got to change. We'll look at that more in detail in a couple of weeks. If your eye is clear, then your whole body will be full of light. You will see the light. You will have a different experience of life on earth if your eye is clear. Is that not motivating to see what's clouding your vision? What keeps you from growth? What keeps you staying in bitterness and anger and makes you want to rant all the time? Some of you sweet ladies have never ranted in your life. Kathy has, I've heard it. No, what is it about men that like to rant? It kind of gives us energy because it makes us feel. It's one of those feelings that is acceptable for men to do. We can sound authoritative and angry and frustrated, and we can see clearly what right thing is and what wrong thing is. So it's one of those things. We can't cry, but we can sure rant. What's more important? Seeing people as they really are, or having the satisfaction of feeling a successful rant come on? What gives you more pleasure and what makes you live a better life? Well, of course. But men love to rant because we can't do much else with our heart. It's not permitted in our culture. We can't cry. We can't call up our buddies and say, man, my heart is broken. They say, what? Dude, let's go get a beer. Let's go play some ball because... God, next thing you know, you're going to cry. Yeah. Men don't have that freedom. If your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. But if the light that is in you is darkness, you will be full of light. If your eye is clear, your whole body will be full of light. If your eye is bad, your whole body will be full of darkness. But if then the light that is in you is darkness, how great is the darkness? He said, you have no hope if your eyes can't see what God wants you to see. You must clear your vision. You must do whatever it takes to get that out of your eye, to get clear so that you can see something God wants you to see. And it's not just something that God wants you to see. He doesn't just want you to see the truth. He doesn't just want you to pick up the Bible and say, wow, that's interesting. Although that's great. My dad had a surgery one time, and he was next to a guy in the hospital that had been a preacher for 50 years. He knew the Bible backwards and forwards, and my dad was really impressed. They shared this room, and this guy would go on and on about the scripture, but eventually my dad just said, get me out of here. This guy won't shut up. You see, the guy didn't even see my dad as a human being. It was just somebody to rant to. You can rant about the Word of God. His heart was not present. I never lost my dad's train of thought about that guy. My dad said something wrong with that guy. He's the most knowledgeable guy about the Word of God I've ever seen, but I don't ever want to see him again. What's wrong there? That's like a Pharisee who understands every part of the law, and Jesus says, "You blind guides, you will swallow a camel while straining out a gnat." The Word of God can be a distraction, just like it can be life-giving grace to your life. If the light that is in you is darkness, you can't see anything. You can only see the bad in people. You can only see the mistakes people make. You can't do anything to see the good. You can't see how the redemptive path they have toward the Lord. I had a politician recently say that many people, fellow citizens, were irredeemable. To which I stood up and screamed, "You want to hear a rant? I'll get on that rant." "You stick to politics," is what I said, "because you stink at theology. How dare you say that your political opponents are irredeemable? It's not your choice whether they're redeemable or not. Every person is within the grace of God. Every single person is within the grace reach of our Lord Jesus Christ. We must live that way, that we believe that, folks. If you don't see the heart that is in people, how dark is your heart? How dark is the darkness that is within you? How great is the darkness, the way that Jesus says it? We'll come back to this passage as well. And in Matthew chapter 13, I don't have time to really go into the details on this. In fact, I'm not even going to try, because we need to study this. This is a great passage where Jesus talks about how people see what they see. But we'll start this next week. We'll pick this up next week. I just want you to walk away from here beginning to ask the question, why can I not see what the Lord wants me to see? But He does want you to see it. Let's pray together. Father, we ask Your blessing upon the reading of Your Word. It is powerful when we hear how much You want us to see the light. You want us to walk in light and not to live in darkness. Father, the darkness signifies distance from You, distance from our own hearts, being detached from our own existence by not knowing who we are. You want to reveal the truth, and that is that we are Your children, made with amazing capacity to know You, to see You, to experience You, and then to share Your healing touch to a world that is in desperate need of redemption. Let us never, ever give in to that tempting feeling or self-righteous feeling of wanting to say that people are irredeemable. Father, You have said that there is no one outside of Your reach but those who choose to stay outside. Let us enter into Your presence and see with a clear vision. May our eyes be unclouded and have clarity that we can walk in the light. In Jesus' name, amen. If you joined us on YouTube, we're really grateful that you were here to join this worship with us today. And I pray that you'll be able to join us again next week. I hope that the service reached you and touched your heart. If there's anything we can do to pray with you, or you want to share prayer requests, please feel free to do that. And we'll see you next week.